Good morning.
Good morning.
It's wonderful to see you here this morning on the seventh Sunday of Easter at Sherwood Episcopal Church in Cockeysville, Maryland. And we also say a warm hello to our friends who are visiting us through the airwaves as we film the service, and we'll always film this service from now on. So welcome to you as well. We're glad that you are with us. As is our custom, we have a few announcements before we begin the service. For those who are here present, we will administer communion after the service. And so your usher at the close, at the end of the postlude, your usher will signal you to get up and come on out to receive communion if you so wish. And you will receive the bread. We are still not receiving the blood of Christ or the wine, but at this point, I hope you will join me for that, and that will take place in our church wing. We had the start of our book club yesterday, which was extremely good, wonderful, and I'm excited about having those four more sessions with the group that we are working with. And then this afternoon at noon, we will start our confirmation class. Those who are a part of it, I'm looking forward to being with you via Zoom at this point, but we are excited about that. And then all of you, I am hoping, may be able to come to the confirmation, which will be at the Cathedral of Our Incarnation, which is our cathedral in the Diocese of Maryland, where Bishop Sutton will confirm both Debbie and Laurie. So I hope we can all be a part of that. And other announcements, one thing, next Saturday, we will be celebrating the life of Virginia Presch Lyon. For those who have been members of this congregation for many years know that Presch died right before COVID, and her family now will be having a service. It will be a private service here at 11 o'clock on next Saturday. I believe it's the 22nd. However, it will be filmed for those who want to attend that. But afterwards, we will take her remains out and escort them out, and we will have the committal by the graveside. And that is where I am hoping as many people from Sherwood and her friends and who can't be here present for the funeral itself will be present for putting the remains into the ground and bidding farewell one last time to Presch Lyon. So take note of that, and if you have any questions, don't hesitate to contact me. And also, please get vaccinated. It is more important than ever. And I will be meeting with the bishops and all clergy on Wednesday, and I'm hoping that we will have some good news about face masks and singing and food and all those things that we've been prohibited to do over the last year and several months. So more news on that later. In the meantime, as we gather together and we gather virtually, let us take just a few moments of silence to gather our thoughts, to open our hearts to hearing God in the music, God in the prayers, God in the scripture, and most importantly, the prayers on your heart that God will touch. I'm glad you're here with us. I look forward to this service in a few moments. Our service begins in our bulletin on page 1. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the King of glory, you have exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. Do not leave us comfortless, but send us your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and exalt us to that place where our Savior Christ is gone, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the first reading.
The first reading is from Acts. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers. Together, the crowd numbered about 120 persons and said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in this ministry. So one of the men who accompanied us during the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John, until the day he was taken up from us. One of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection." So they proposed two: Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justus, and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take place in this ministry, an apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. The word of the Lord.
Thanks.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 1. We will read responsively by whole verse. Happy are they who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the way of sinners, nor sat in the seats of the scornful. They are like trees planted by streams of water, bearing fruit in due season, with leaves that do not wither. Everything they do shall prosper.
It is not so with the wicked. They are like chaff which the wind blows away.
Therefore, the wicked shall not stand upright when judgment comes, nor the sinner in the counsel of the righteous.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked is doomed.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus prayed, I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept their word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I'm not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as you are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost, except the one destined to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I'm coming to you, and I speak these things in the world, so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they may also be sanctified in truth. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Amen.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, my Lord, my strength, and my Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Sarah was a member of the Episcopal Church and extremely faithful to God and her church community. She and her husband were foster parents to over 50 children, and she exemplified a committed Christian woman inside and out. One of Sarah's gifts was her skill of prayer. She often was the person who would take the new, unexperienced priest and take him to visit those who were homebound. She would introduce the priest to the homebound person, and then she would sit down and remain silent as the priest and the parishioner got to know one another. Throughout the entire visit, she was present and she was attentive. Her prayers reflected a heart that was open, wide to hear not only the words that were exchanged between the parishioner and the priest, but subtle nuances as well. You see, at the end of their time together, Sarah would always ask, "Father or Mother, may I pray at the end?" And they would always say yes. And her prayers would capture the true essence of what was going on in that space. The needs, the hopes, the sorrows, and the joys on the heart of the parishioner. And she'd summarize it all in one beautiful prayer. A prayer whose words, I would suspect, would literally wrap around the parishioner in the loving arms of God. Sarah's prayers often rendered the priest speechless and thankful for her holy presence. Sarah passed away just a few weeks ago. I have no doubt she joined a chorus of angels in prayer as she passed from this life to her new life. Now, the gospel reading from John today is about Jesus praying at the end of his life. Unlike other times where Jesus went off to pray, he remained in the presence of his friends, the disciples. They were sitting right before him as he began to pray aloud, first offering thanks to God, and then in the part that we hear today, he prayed to God for and about his beloved community, the community that he was about to leave. This prayer is known as the high priestly prayer, and it reflects the gospel writer, the Johannine writer's constant reference and understanding that God and Jesus were one. Just imagine yourselves as a disciple beside Jesus. You have watched him touch the untouchables, heal those lost to their illnesses, and attract crowds so large that you had to row Jesus out on a boat in the middle of the lake so all the crowds could hear him. And then Jesus prays, something you have watched him do so many times before, but this time he prays aloud, and you realize he is praying about you. The words of Jesus just wash over you like a soothing balm. Prayers to reinforce you. Prayers to give you guidance. Prayers to strengthen you. Now, as Christians, we know about the power of prayer, but I wonder how many of us only see prayer as words that we offer up to God at the end of the day, or when something good happens to you, or maybe when we gather on a Sunday morning. There are so much more to prayer, and in particular, what Jesus was asking of God. Jesus' time, as I said, was coming to an end. He knew that what his Father had sent him to do, he had done. He was going to return to God. So he asked God to protect the disciples. Jesus knew they would be subject to the same ridicule and the same challenges that he experienced on earth. He knew some of these disciples would die in his name. So Jesus calls on God to watch over and to protect his people who will continue to be of the world. And he says, I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Now, a little bit of education in regards to that wording. It is important to know that Jesus' reference to the world in this context is not about the physical world in and of itself. It was of those of the world who rejected Jesus as one with God. Jesus prayed, asking God to protect his friends because he no longer was going to be there to protect them. Jesus' prayers weren't simply empty words. They were prayers of substance, laced with his deep love and care for his friends, just as Sarah's prayers were with those that she visited. You know, that is why we, the people of faith, we gather together in community. To be a follower of Christ is to be a part of a group committed to growing in faith. The Christian journey is not a solo journey. It is a journey with fellow believers and even fellow doubters. And the way we gather as a community is actually through prayer. Our entire worship service that you are experiencing now in the present or through the waves, this is a swirl of prayers. Whether we gather physically or virtually, we are all together in this beautiful, mystical swirl. The prelude that Greg plays every Sunday is a gathering of musical notes that form as a prayer on our hearts so that we can prepare for worship. We begin with the collect of purity placed at the beginning of the service that sets the tone for our entire worship. Our prayers are expressed through the hymns that Cassidy sings. There are prayers for all the world and for those we don't even like. There are prayers with inscription in scriptures, and we will stand in a few minutes to confess our sins through a prayer, and we will recite the Lord's Prayer as one voice to God. And at the close of the service, we pray together a prayer that sends us out to share God's love in the world. Even our mission statement is a prayer. All the prayers serve as a catalyst that strengthen us to be the light of Christ in the world. Just as Jesus prayed aloud for all to hear, we do the same. We do the same in this community together. We are called to pray regularly, consistently, and intentionally so we ourselves can be strengthened and so are others strengthened whose needs we may or may not know, but God certainly does. When we offer to pray for another, we offer ourselves. They are not empty words. And that cliche, I will pray for you, has been thrown around so carelessly. I encourage us to often also know that when we say that, we are offering ourselves to the other. In other words, our words must be backed by our presence with the love for others, our willingness to walk with others, stand with others, speak out on behalf of others, or simply be with others so they feel God's presence in palpable ways. Jesus was praying to God to do the same, and God complied by instilling the disciples with the Holy Spirit. That is how prayer works. It isn't about God sitting on a throne high in heaven, taking a tally of those in need. It is about our God accompanying us in this world, our God guiding us, prompting us, bringing us clarity when we need it, and also refuge from the storm. In fact, we are often God's messengers of prayer, whether we realize it or not. God's presence swirls all around us every single moment of the day. It is up to us, to you, to me, to show up and take hold of God's presence so our hearts are filled with His loving Spirit. One of the gifts of being your priest is when you share your holy moments with me that leave you in awe. Recently, I received a call from Maria, one of our parishioners, and she has given me permission to share her story. Maria was struggling with something. For days, she prayed to God to guide her with what was weighing on her heart. She remained persistent, even though she wasn't sure God heard her or not. And this went on for several days. Then something happened when she was mindlessly running errands. As she stood in the checkout line, she glanced at those items, those last-minute items that the store hopes that you will grab, you know, the tabloids and the chewing gum and all of that. And as she glanced at that array of things, something caught her eyes, and it was a book titled 100 Days of Prayer. She said, "I don't even know why I did it, but I went and I instinctively picked it up and I opened it up randomly to a particular page and I read the prayer for that day." As she began to read the words, she realized it was the prayer that she needed to hear in respect to the personal prayers that she had been lifting up to God. Suddenly, the words on the page, she said, leaped out, and she felt this sudden rush of relief, a rush of relief that she had been seeking for so many days. Her heart absorbed the love in the words from the page, and she knew God had been and continues to be right there with her. Even in the checkout line in Burlington. Was her problem suddenly fixed? No, it wasn't. But it realigned her attitude. It realigned her understanding. It broadened her scope of that particular issue that she was struggling with. No longer was she anxious, lost, or confused, and she wasn't even angry as she struggled with the issue before her. A simple moment in time that was monumental in the life of our friend. That, my friends, is exactly what Jesus was doing when he invited his disciples to hear his prayer for them. He was calling upon God, the one from whom he came, to touch, to move, to open the hearts of his friends whom he loved dearly, so that they would never feel alone, never feel abandoned, but strengthened to find the courage to spread Christ's love even in the face of evil. His prayer to the Father was that they would ultimately obtain the same joy that he had, a joy that he knew will make them complete. Let us follow the example of Jesus and Sarah as they prayed what was on their heart for those who surrounded them. And let us remain awake and vulnerable to receive the power of prayer as the disciples and Maria did. In doing so, we will all realize God's dream and find deep joy within our hearts and the hearts of others. Amen. And now let us stand to recite the Nicene Creed. It's found on page 6 of your bulletin. Saying together, we believe in one God, Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally
of the people. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly humbly serve you.
That we may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your glorious sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
We especially pray for those impacted by COVID-19. As well as those on our parish prayer list, Sally, Debbie, Shannon, Jeff and Kim, Norma, Margaret, Ed, Laura, Joyce, Christine, Mike and his family, Kendall, Marge, Sarah, Joe, Gail, Steve W., Michelle, Joe G., Jay, Rick, Ella May, Steve and Debbie, Janetta, Christina, Khalil, Charles, Samantha, Courtney, Debbie H., Danny, Sandy and Jack, Jen, the Laurie family, Virginia, Susie H., the Alexander family, Kiernan and Colleen, Linda P., the Saria family, Timothy, Ralph, and Barbara Y. We give you thanks for the blessings of this life, especially for those celebrating birthdays, as well as anniversaries, including Ralph and Anne. Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Lord, hear the prayers of your people and what we have asked faithfully. Grant that we may obtain effectually to the glory of your name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And now let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor, saying together, most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sin through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Amen. My sisters and brothers, together here and afar, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another in peace. Peace all. And peace to our friends who are on the internet. And you may be seated. And now let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Amen.
us stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, for he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sanctified for us and was taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. The night that he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of all new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
let us say together the prayer for spiritual communion found on the bottom of page 12 of your bulletin. Saying together, in union, O Lord, with your faithful people at every altar of your church, where the Holy Eucharist is now being celebrated, we desire to offer to you praise and thanksgiving. We remember your death, Lord Christ. We proclaim your resurrection. We await your coming in glory. And since we cannot receive you today in the sacrament of your body and blood, we beseech you to come spiritually into our hearts. Cleanse and strengthen us with your grace, Lord Jesus. And let us never be separated from you. May we live in you and you in us, in this life and the life to come. Amen. And now go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage, hold fast to which is good. Render no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the afflicted, honor everyone. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit and the blessing of God Almighty. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. As we go forth into the world refreshed and renewed, we reaffirm our commitment to our mission as a congregation, saying together, God commands us to enthusiastically cast open our doors to embrace all, impacting lives through bold service, no exception. And now, my sisters and brothers, let us go forth to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God, alleluia, alleluia.
Amen.